Welcome back to another session of Spotlight. And today we have Andy Paluri. He's a Middlesex County College Board of Trustees. Andy has about 33 years of experience, and he's a licensed engineer, and his party affiliation is Democratic. Welcome, Andy.
Thank you, Krishna.
And we have here with Jinesh Patel. He is Middlesex County Republican Board, Republican County Board member. Welcome, Jinesh.
Thank you, Krishna. Thank you. Hello, everyone.
I'm expecting another guest. Anyway, we will go ahead and talk to each other about the set topic. You know, like in both the campaigns, China has been one of the pivotal points, either for the Trump people as well as in a negative way for the Biden camp. So we would like to see the effect of China on Biden and Trump, and in fact, for the future of USA and the world. So welcome, both of you. And then let us start with Jinesh. Tell us about your views in this aspect. Like, I want you to stick to the topic, China, Trump, Biden, world, USA future.
Absolutely. So thank you, Krishna, for inviting me to today's debate. So in the context of China, United States, and especially in respect to Trump and Biden, recently we are seeing a lot of debate going and allegations back and forth about, Trump campaign alleging that Biden has given some contracts to his, when he was the vice president, he's got some contracts for his son from China. Again, that's a matter of investigation. I just saw news that, Department of Justice has opened some investigation related to it. But again, that's a matter of investigation. But in terms of China, I know for sure that in the past, China has, always, provoked democratic countries and tried to, play in with their leaders, including, bribing them or giving them favors in order to get favors in return. Right. So, and I'm sure that Trump, has come clean in the last 3.5 to 4 years because he's not even taking a single dollar of salary. And America continues to become the leader, and driving the world's, economy in terms of, science innovations, discovery, and in terms of the overall growth, right? So in order for this to continue, I think that Trump is the right candidate at this point for the re-election of his presidential, candidature, rather than, Joe Biden, which was, we have already seen his last, 8 years when he was VP, what he has done to the country and the world.
Andy, your opening remarks, and then after that, you can contradict each other, sir.
Yeah, he said he's a Trump supporter. So I'm just wondering if you need a mute button or not. But anyway.
No. We are more...
The intent is not to make a fiery statements to get at each other. I think we can have a civilized conversation and agree to disagree on things. You introduced me, Krishna. My name is Anand Paluri, actually. I've been here for the last 34 years. I'm an engineer by trade, and I run a major infrastructure company, a global company, its operations in the Northeast region. So that's my role. But on my spare time, while I'm not doing that, I'm actively involved in the local politics. I'm on the planning board. I served as the Kshetriya commissioner, and I've been elected to the Board of Education in Monroe. And most recently, Governor Murphy has appointed me to the Middlesex County Community College. So to getting back to your question about the role of China, any dictatorial country with aspirations always looks to expand their geographic territories. And we have seen that with Saddam Hussein, we have seen that with Putin, and now we're seeing with the premier of China. So the two separate independent things going on here. One is the financial aspect of it. You could say Biden has got contracts, or Trump has a bank account itself conducting business in China as well. So, all these aside, that's one part of it. People do business across the countries, like we're all doing. But more importantly, I think the from a context of how it impacts India, I think that a solid relationship, not just economic, but also from a military perspective, is extremely important. And when I see the newspapers that the U.S. Secretary of State is meeting up with our defense ministry in India and trying to create this pact that they would defend us in case of military aggression by the neighboring countries, it's definitely something that's I feel is a path, whether you're a Democrat or Republican, I think that path will continue moving forward into the next election. And that's a welcome news for any democratic country that if these dictatorial countries take over smaller countries like it happened in Middle East with Iraq taking over Kuwait, and if nobody intervenes with it, then where do we stop, right? So I think, you know, there's no doubt that China is more powerful than India from a technology perspective and arms perspective. And if that is the only criteria for a neighboring country to come and take over, then we can probably do the same thing from India also, taking over Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, and Pakistan. So that's not the intent. You know, we respect the sovereignty of every country. And I think having the pact between the US and India is definitely a welcome from my perspective.
Thank you. You have any points to oppose? And issues, yes. Janesh?
Yes, Krishna. So I would like to add, Andy, you know, I appreciate that he also appreciates the pact between US and India and Australia and Japan. They have created quad countries. I tweeted this on my Twitter last year that all the democratic countries in the world, including United States, is posing a serious threat from China's, you know, communist regime. And here we have this COVID-19, you know, where we don't know whether the, you know, virus was created in the laboratory or whether, you know, it came from animals. Right, but we definitely know for the fact that it was intentionally spread across the globe, where China did not allow it to spread outside the Wuhan. Right. At the same time, China continues to be, you know, fascist communist dictator regime with human, you know, very worst human rights violation records. Right. Whether it's against the Uyghur Muslims, whether it's against the Tibet, you know, there's a Tibetan regime government living in exile in Dharamshala in India. Right. Whether creating a Gwadar port in Pakistan, going through this, you know, this CPC going through the Pak occupied Kashmir, which is also illegal. And whether it's, you know, crushing the Hong Kong protests or all. So not giving a recognition to Taiwan, you know, and whether it's bullying in the, you know, their smaller neighbors, whether it's giving them loans at higher rates, and when they know that these countries cannot repay it back to them, you know, taking their assets like the ports in order to deploy their militarial and naval and air force assets against the other powerful countries, you know, and including bullying in the South China Sea.
I think Andy has made a point that every dictatorial nation or totalitarian nation, they want to expand beyond their geographical limits. Fine. Soviet Union has tried some time back, and then it met its dust in 1985. Okay, but what Soviet Union was doing at that point of time is possibly it is spending all its resources in expanding the communism throughout the entire world. An example of that one is when I was child, I think, 6-7 years old, we used to get a Soviet Bhumi, a magazine in Soviet land, a magazine in our village, which doesn't even have electricity. We used to tear the pages because nice paper, and then we used to make it as a book covers. Okay, that was that's how the Soviet Union has spent its money. Versus now, China is a formidable economic power, and exactly as Soviet Union has the intention of expanding its whether communism or not necessarily geography, they wanted to expand communism. Here, these guys want to expand their geography. And they have a lot of money power. They have a lot of things, and then illegal, rather not so disciplined activities to get the technology and other things. So in this context, what is going to happen, Andy, about their ambition of being a superpower or their imperialistic views?
As I mentioned to you when we were talking earlier, I just got finished up a Zoom call with Congressman Donald Norcross, who was actually on the Senate Arms Committee. And so one of the questions that I asked him...
I think I have to introduce one of our new member who joined late, Ms. Manga. Manga, good evening to you. And she is a congressional candidate from Virginia CA. Virginia CD11. And then welcome, Manga. And we have here Andy Paluri, is aligned towards Republican Party, and then Manga is a, I'm sorry, you are a Democratic Party, and then Manga is a Republican candidate from Virginia City 11. Okay, go ahead, Andy. Sorry for interrupting you.
As I mentioned, I was just got off the call, Zoom call with Congressman Don Norcross, and one of the questions I asked him is the fairness of election and the potential foreign interference. The way it relates to the question you're asking me is, he said, right now there are four separate threats that are going on within the United States for the elections. Number one appears to be Russia. They're actively involved in it. Number two is China, definitely involved, and they're seeing a lot of interference with them. Third is Iran. And right now, North Korea is also getting involved in the US elections. Both China and North Korea, not only getting involved in elections, one of the things that came through the debriefs is the fact that they're going to be targeting the hospital and medical systems within the US over the next couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. There are already apparently ransomware attacks that are going on the medical hospitals. You probably know what I'm talking about, which is, you know, all their medical records and everything freezes. They put a ransom of $5 million, $10 million, only then they release them. So it's not a conventional war. It's a cyber war. It's off the beaten path of how people used to conduct themselves. It's basically a blackmailing by a state-sponsored terrorism, cyber terrorism, if you will. All these things are happening because of the special interests. You know I got two Republicans here. I'm the only Democrat, but I can tell you that this country needs a change. It country needs a change right away. And what we have seen over the 4 years is deception, lies. I mean, as immigrants, what we have experienced being here, like I said, I've been here for 34 years, and I never felt that my skin color, my native origin of where I came from ever mattered in this country. The opportunity was open to everybody. But over the last 4 years, being an elected member in my township and being active in the politics, I definitely feel it that whatever the anger that was inside the people, maybe the anger was not created by Trump, but definitely he validated it. He approved it. He said it's okay to come out and be very racial and that is really created the difference, the divide within the country. Doesn't matter where we go, the divide is clearly visible, that we never seen this nation ever go through such kind of a divide.
Manga, your views. I was asking that China has muscle power as well as money power to flex anything, to expand its geographic as well as non-geographic origins like technology, things like that. And then that is Andy's use. And then you can tell your views on how China can impact Biden, Trump, USA, and world.
Thanks, Krishnaji, for having us on your spotlight. I always enjoy coming on your show and expressing my views and sharing. Definitely, there is a lot of cyber terrorism and war going on. That is the very modus operandi of China that has always been, and also for Russia. There's absolutely no doubt about it. Mr. Andy Paluri is right that there is a lot of cyber war and terrorism going on. But the only thing I would have to refute what Mr. Andy has to say is it's all because of President Trump's racial divide. I think in this country, if at all there's any racial divide, that's all coming from the left. I've always been, I don't know about his experience. He sounds so Indian and less of American. Whereas I have been working for 24 years exclusively with white Americans, and I have never ever had to work with one Indian co-worker, and I have never felt the kind of any racial discrimination or divide, or because of that, me being a brown woman, I have any had any issues. Right now, yeah, if at all there is any China involvement in our politics, I think that's all being contributed because of Joe Biden and Hunter Biden, the kind of the relationship they have had, the business relationship and the very, very repulsive relationship they've had with China and becoming so anti-American, all these sentiments are coming from the left. I don't think ever in this country, racial divide has been a problem. And if at all I'm being discriminated, I think all the hate is coming from the left. Even when I go to polls, then if all loving Democrats, if they are so open to race, color, and everything. And when I go on, I poll hop every single day from September, from morning 9 o'clock until almost it is closed at 7, and it goes up to 8 o'clock, talking to voters. And the only time and only people who insult me, even as a candidate, when I just go say hello to them, it's all coming from the left, the Democrats. I have never seen anybody other than Democrats insult or hate anybody or their color. And definitely, if at all there is a China war involved, that's all being welcomed by Joe and Joe, his son, Hunter Biden, Nancy Pelosi, and all her puppets.
Okay, Jinesh, your views.
Yes, on a lighter note, you know, I hope Andy was running as as president instead of Biden, because what Biden thinks is it's in the interest of United States that China becomes a superpower. I think it's the interest of only, in the Biden's interest that China becomes superpower, not in the interest of United States of America. But let me answer your question, Krishna. You asked about, expansionist policies of China, right? Because I think it's very, very much barbaric, China continues to occupy and having, issues with territorial issues with all of its neighbors, including Russia. You know, recently they invaded, Ladakh in India. They are continuing to occupy illegal territory of, Xichai Chin. They are claiming illegally Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh and so on and so forth. China also, when you talked about, hacking of, American secrets and stealing some of the American secrets, like, for example, Moderna company is doing, it's the front runner of doing the vaccine development, right? They are in the final stage of vaccine development. When they were in the first or second phase, there was, I think Department of Justice or FBI or maybe CIA found out that there were intruders from China trying to hack into the system and steal the research data into the Moderna or any of the companies, right? So that's one issue of it. But coming back to, your question about Russia and China relationships also, right? So I think that's a natural alignment because both are a communist country and Russian industry is dependent on oil, natural gas and the defense only sector, right? While the China is, having a overall development. And again, I would say it's everything that China does, they are nothing but copycats of America and other countries. So, in this nuclear world, most of its neighbor is having nuclear weapons like India. There is no way that you can continue this expansionist policies and grab others' lands. Maybe, they can continue doing with Nepal or some smaller countries of them. But I think I'm in the favor. In order to deter China from its, expansionist policies, India, United States, UK, Japan, and all these countries needs to empower countries like Taiwan, Nepal, Bangladesh, Bhutan with nuclear weapons, including Taiwan and other countries in order to protect themselves and their sovereignty.
I'd like to add something to Mr. Patel has added. Although I definitely agree with him on empowering Taiwan and other countries and in that Southeast region, I don't think nuclear weapons is the way to go. And absolutely controlling China about its expansion of territories, I do agree with him. And definitely that needs to be stopped. And India and US can be playing a very pivotal role in having that role, bringing peace to that region. So I think I'm 90% with Jignesh Patelji.
Thank you very much. But both of you are saying, Andy as well as Manga, you are saying that, there is racism. But we are talking about China. Do I understand this racism is due to China or is it due to whatever policies or whatever rhetorics that both the parties have? That is one of my questions. Okay. Let me come to, I'll give you time to answer this question, but I have another question. But first, let us answer, each one of you have one minute. How China plays a role in the racism of America? Because both of you told so, Manga as well as Andy.
How does China play a racial role in the US? Is that your question?
No, you said that there is racism, and my question is about China. You told that there is racism in America, which is
well, we have seen
how China is responding. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
China is not responsible for racism. You know, the elected officials need to choose their words extremely carefully when they speak of a problem. And the guy in the White House right now doesn't do that. And we all know he doesn't do that, even if somebody disagrees. So he constantly calls the virus as China virus. And we have seen a number of Chinese establishments being attacked by the fundamental Proud Boys, so to speak. So I think that is one of the symptoms. It's not the only racial problem. You know, I'm not saying that the racial divide did not exist in the US from the beginning. It did. You know, it was overcoming over decades of slavery and the women's voting rights and things like that. But I think in the 4 years, if somebody tells me that it did not take an ugly turn where it has been widely accepted, then they really have their head in the sand and they don't know what's going on throughout the country. You know, it doesn't matter whether you work with white folks or brown folks or whether you're a Democrat or a Republican or what state you live in. Across the country, the number of racial divide incidents that took place have never taken place any time in the last couple of decades. So the issue is two independent things here. It's not the one size fit all. I think the Chinese were also subject to the racial issues, just like anyone else. I mean, you know,
you said that China is definitely interfering in the elections. Does it mean, is it creating a racial divide among people by some way or the other?
No, not that I'm aware of. I mean, if they are, no, it's purely, I mean, obviously you cannot go vote by vote and change the votes, but they're looking at a bigger system to see how they can interfere with the systems. And even, you know, ransomware and stealing of the voter identities and things like that. As I think Mr. Jinesh Patel kind of mentioned earlier, that they don't do the trading in a fair way. The Chinese philosophy of trading is that they can take a $600 instrument that you're using and how they can manufacture that for $6 and flood the market with it and kind of, you know, and kind of negate the other the inventors of the product itself. So that's how they overtake the markets. And that's probably the type of thing that's going on right now. But specific to the elections, like I said, I don't know the details of how they're trying to interfere, but there is definitely interference that the cyber attacks that the State Department is extremely watching with a close eye.
Thank you, Andy. To Manga, to you.
Yes, I mean, I just want to mention there is a difference between President calling China virus a China virus because or a Wuhan virus because it came from China. You should be calling it a China virus. There is a difference between calling a virus that came from China as a China virus versus discriminating Chinese Americans. He did not just say Chinese American virus. He called it China virus. There is a difference. Chinese American should never or ever feel so discriminated or do not like China virus being called China. I think my friend Andy should clearly have that differentiation between Chinese
Could you please
China
explain
virus.
To me then why the Chinese business establishments are being attacked?
That's all because of the Democrats pumping trash into people and whoever are involved in this rioting and burning of cities and looting, they're all Democrats and Antifas. I mean, that's who your party is supporting. And tell me which Republican city has ever had any violent rioting or burning down the cities other than your Democrat cities. I mean, wherever Hindus were being harmed, they're all Democrat cities. And wherever all this is happening, they're all Democrat cities. You show one Republican city, I will take that for a word. You cannot show one Republican city that would act irresponsibly like the Democrat cities or the Democrat leadership. I think they lack leadership, they lack patriotism, they lack American views and sense of belonging to America. They have all become anti-American and useless. That's exactly what I think, and that's exactly what is happening. Show me one example where a Republican city has been burned down and looted and violent rioting has happened. It can never happen. It will never happen because...
Thank you, Manga. You have 30 seconds to answer Andy for this one before we go to the next session. Next question. Let Andy speak.
Okay. So I want to first respond to Manga, you know, about the nuclear for 5-10 seconds, and then I'll go back to Krishna's question, right? So I also believe that either all the countries should have the nuclear weapons or no country should have the nuclear weapon. But with a note that those rogue regimes of the world, whether it's Syria, North Korea, Iran, I'm against these countries having nuclear weapons, you know? So on that purpose, coming back to, you know, Krishna's and Andy's point, right? Basically, racism related to China. I don't think there's any racism related to saying it's a Chinese virus or a Wuhan virus. You know, our laws and courts will take care of if there is any racism. But at the same time, we cannot justify violence. What we saw in Minneapolis and, you know, Minnesota and other states, Philadelphia, all the Democratic, you know, cities were burning, you know, police stations, cars, and the governments were doing nothing. Okay, until Trump said, okay, I will bring an army or National Guard in order to control these cities. These guys, in the fear of not getting their votes, they were doing nothing. Okay, this is unacceptable. As an American citizen, this is unacceptable to me because I believe the United States is a country of laws. Now, coming back to earlier point, right, about, you know, what can China do in order to spread racism also, right? So there were a few applications banned recently in India, more than 60 applications, including TikTok, and in America also. TikTok was banned in terms of looking at the security threats. Now, what China can do is not just gather the user information, but can start mass, you know, bombarding of, you know, sending this, you know, advertisements or notification that can create, you know, polarization in the U.S. society. So I think that's more threatful than, you know, thinking about what Trump said and what's going to happen and whatnot. And again, don't forget, you know, Nancy Pelosi in the San Francisco Chinatown was saying, you know, let the, you know, why no problem of the virus. Let's have the China parade. Similarly, New York mayor was saying it. I think on the first priority should be the national security and safety of our citizens. Then looking at the racism, these are the secondary or things.
Thank you, Jinesh. Yeah. To you, Andy.
Nobody who is a true patriot, or forget about patriotism, just a human being, would want to see violence on the streets. If you look at the majority of the street of the cities within the United States, most of them are democratic controlled. I'm not sure if either one of these Republican Kool-Aid drinkers could tell me which major city that the Republicans are controlling. But what happens is in the inner cities, there is a huge amount of minorities, and that's why they become democratic, is because they feel they're oppressed. By no means I'm suggesting, or any sensible Democrat will ever say that, you know, violence is acceptable. But it's an outrage that takes off, and then the antisocial elements come into play, destroying the properties. But the notion that the Democrats are not capable of governing, I have no words even to rebut something like that to say. It almost sounds like what Ms. Manga is suggesting, is there's a separate DNA for Republican, that there's a separate DNA for Democrats, and the Republicans only have the DNA to govern where the Democrats don't have. I think that's so divisive. And I really regret that our own community people feel that strongly about what they actually see day in, day out on the TV, what they read, and what we hear from our own friends in the community, what they're going through, and drink that Kool-Aid like they're doing. To me, this is unfathomable.
Thank you. We have 1 more minute before we close the show, sir. Final remarks from Manga.
Is the oppression of self-imposed power that Democrats are absolutely missing for the last, they are just having a hard time accepting. They did not even accept 2016 elections, and here we are with the 2020 elections. Get a grip, people. You know, it's already 4 years, and you're still living in 2016. 4 years have passed. So come up and with a better solution and a better thinking.
Thank you. Final 10 seconds to you, Jinesh.
Yes, my final words are America should continue the lead as the, global leader in innovation and science and technology, and should not hesitate, in punishing China or holding them accountable for human rights violations, whether it's a COVID-19 spreads or bringing back manufacturing from China or any of their neighboring, bullying tactics or integral discharges. So I think President Trump is the best person for dealing with China at this point, and Joe Biden is nowhere near coming close in terms of his credentials. Thank you.
Thank you. You have 10 seconds, Sandy, before we close.
I agree with everything Mr. Patel said, the first half of his comments, and I think Trump is absolutely the wrong person to lead this country anymore. I think we have gone through serious issues, and I think it's time that the guy steps down and somebody with some experience, somebody with some morale, somebody with some values get in the White House to lead this country and stop the divide that we're going through right now.
Thank you, viewers. I think this is a heated discussion.